I'd like to ask everyone, please, to take a moment of silent contemplation for prayer and reflection. Keep our men and women in our armed forces in your thoughts and prayers, as well as those in our public safety. Thank you. Please rise for the pledge.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right. Well, first on our agenda this morning, we have Positively Carroll. Is there anything that anybody wanted to share this morning?
Yeah, I would like to bring up, I was at the Adult Education Diploma Recognition Ceremony on the 23rd. It was a great thing to attend. I was going to tell you how many people graduate, but I don't have that in front of me. Anyway, these are people that, for some reason or another, did not continue their education at the normal course, I guess you would say, go through high school. Events caused them to drop out of high school, then went back and did the work that was necessary to get their high school diploma. And actually, one of the most moving things that I heard, because at the end, they get like a PowerPoint, brief one like Commissioner Rothschild's, a PowerPoint presentation at the end, and they have, each person has something up there, and one lady said that she will proudly put her diploma next to her son's. That meant a lot to me from reading that. And I think great that these people go through this program, especially think it's great that the teachers that are there to help them out and to mentor them through this. It's just a fantastic program for the county.
For those of you out there who dread those times when you have to spend an hour or two at the MVA, our local business, Terry's Tag and Title, opened up its sixth location in Union Bridge at 52 North Main Street. And if you need any titling or tag services for your car and you want to avoid the long lines at the MVA, go see Terry.
All right, and just in about a week and a half, we'll have our Veterans Day celebrations across the county. Many of the schools are doing events. A lot of organizations are doing events. We're trying to cover as many of those as possible, but we strongly encourage folks to look into those ahead of time. Many of the programs are very, very well done, and it is important, I think, for us to take time at least once a year and reflect on those that have been willing to serve the country and make sure that if that's not lost on the next generation, and that we have some firsthand experiences and talks and things like that from folks that each year we lose a few more, and there are less and less folks that can give a good firsthand talk about all that we went through to protect the country. Also, Saturday night will be Halloween. Halloween falling on a Saturday night is kind of cool. I was going to go as Commissioner Rothschild this year, but the costume sold out, so that was kind of an unfortunate thing. But just be conscious of the fact that it does get dark early. Trick-or-treaters are out early. A lot of times when we're on side streets and things like that, we're really not, they're not always as visible as they should be. Just take it slow. We obviously want to get through a happy and safe holiday weekend.
So. Mr. Howard, I want you to know that out of respect for our friendship, I'm not going to respond with any jokes about imitating a conservative or anything like that. Just kidding.
Pretending to be a conservative.
Just kidding.
Sometimes it's the joke that's not told. It's the funniest one.
This is our trick or treat session.
This is the treat part of it. Yeah.
And for the record, being in between, I got a whole bunch. So
I bet you did.
Just going to let that go too.
All right, well, first on our agenda this morning, we have a briefing, discussion, and decision on the execution. And we generally don't do executions on Thursday, so the execution of a bond resolution. And we're going to ask our comptroller, Mr. Robert, to come up and be joined, and we'll let him do introductions.
Good morning, commissioners.
Good morning.
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 To see you gentlemen again.
Yes, I'll introduce the gentleman joining me at the table, two gentlemen from our bond counsel firm of McKinnon, Shelton, and Henn. I have Mr. Bill Henn and Mr. David Gregory with us this morning.
Morning.
As well as you're all familiar with Mr. Sam Ketterman, financial advisory firm, Davenport & Company. And we are here this morning to bring before the board an authorizing resolution for the issuance of bonds. This is an annual process, and this kind of begins the legal end of the county's authority to issue bonds. We're seeking authority for a $28 million new issue. I've attached the project listing to your briefing that outlines those projects. Projects prior approval through the budget process, and the majority of these projects are at or near completion. We've already spent these dollars. About $16 million of the $28 million issuance will be in the form of reimbursing ourselves for costs already incurred. The second part of the issue seeks authority for $13.38 million, which authorizes a refunding of outstanding bonds from 2007. The current market interest rate environment is favorable to a refunding, and so we've included the authority to do a refunding if the savings are realized on the day of sale. So that part is not a commitment, but it's our intention to take advantage of the market if those savings remain when we go to sale on November 19th. So we've got some time until sale. If the market changes and the savings aren't there to be had, then that portion of the sale will not take place. But all that's outlined in the authorization. So our intention there is debt service savings to be able to reduce the fixed costs that we already have through refunding and reduce the amount that we will then be obligated to pay. I think that was all I kind of needed to cover in general. If the board has any questions, I'd be glad to do that. Otherwise, I'll ask Mr. Ketterman, maybe just to give a brief overview of what our intentions are.
I know I'm going to be asked, sure. So I might as well ask it right now, knock it out of the way. So if we issue $28 million, how many millions will we be discharging this year, and what would that do to our net outstanding our capital amount?
So $28 million, our new borrowing for the year. Yeah. I don't think I have it directly in front of me. If I am recalling, we're retiring just slightly above that, somewhere around $29.5 million, okay. About $1.5 million in net debt retirement in the current year.
Perfect. Good. Good.
Failed to mention, and wanted to be clear, when, and maybe Mr. Ketterman can follow up, when we are doing a refunding, we are using market and interest rate savings only. It is not an extension of the terms or the length of the payout. So we're not simply shifting or pushing back debt. It's got to produce savings with the interest rates themselves.
Commissioners, I think Mr. Burke explained the process rather clearly. We are in a situation, as he mentioned, that the interest rate environment is favorable to a refunding. The transaction that we propose to refund is the county's 2007 issue. And presently, if the bonds were to be sold today, the county would realize debt service savings of approximately $490,000. And of course, we don't know what the rates are going to be come the middle of November, but at this moment, you're looking at that kind of level of savings, and that's, in my mind, very attractive.
And Sam, that 490 comes over the remaining length of time for the...
Most of it will be realized in the first 4 years from fiscal year 16 through 19.
So that's 125 a year approximately?
That would just be an arithmetic average, Commissioner, but actually most of it is realized, over 400,000 of it is realized in fiscal year 19 based on the present interest rate market. Now, interest rates, depending upon how they're assigned in the bond sale, will determine where the savings fall, but that's where it is at the moment.
All right, thank you.
All right. Do we have a motion to approve the bond resolution?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any other questions or discussion? All right, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. And Rob, you'll have us
we will
execute
be back
that?
We'll leave the originals for your signature after session, and then we will be back on November 19th with the results of the actual sale and award to the lowest bidder at that time.
Very good.
Okay.
Gentlemen, thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Next, we have a briefing, discussion, and decision on a request approval of the strategic planning grant application for the local management board. So we have joining us Patty Whitson, our acting director for the Department of Citizen Services, Vince Pacelli, our manager of the local management board. Good morning.
Good morning, Commissioner.
Good morning.
The Governor's Office for Children provides state funding to the local management board to oversee and fund community agencies and services that enhance child and family well-being in Carroll County. The agencies and services selected for funding are based on an evaluation and rating of the community needs, as well as an assessment of the quality of programming and services provided. I'm going to turn it over to Vince because there's some changes in the or shifts in the focus of this funding, so I'm going to let him explain that to you.
Good morning, all.
Good morning.
Earlier this year, the Governor's Office of Children announced that the office was shifting their focus for their state funding over the next 3 years to address four specific groups of youth and their families. Number one was reduce the impact of parental incarceration on youth, families, and communities. Number two was improve outcomes for disconnected youth. Disconnected youth are described as ages 16 to 24, not in school or in the workforce. Number three was reduce childhood hunger. And number four was reduce youth homelessness, and youth were between the ages of 14 and 25. In order to understand the size and needs of these groups in each jurisdiction, the Governor's Office of Children is offering the opportunity to apply for up to $25,000 to conduct activities such as data collection and analysis, community surveys and focus groups, resource gaps analysis, a community needs assessment, and community planning. If awarded, the grant will help the local management board answer how large each of these groups are in Carroll County, what barriers to success that the youth in each group are faced with, what current services are provided within the county, and what gaps our county may have in providing services to these youth. The local management board staff will work with the local management board and a consultant to carry out the strategic planning activities. As mentioned, this amount is $25,000, and we recommend that this application be approved.
All right. Is there a motion to approve the application?
So moved.
Second. Any questions or discussion?
So when we get this data, first of all, I would assume that this is data that we can't currently do ourselves, collection.
It's quite expansive. We currently have a small contract with Sadek & Associates. I kind of inherited it when I took over the position. They were primarily doing work in regard to parents as teachers. In light of our new focus from the GOC, I asked if they could switch gears and start working on disconnected youth. They said that would not be a problem. So they've already started working on that project, and we selected disconnected youth because if you look at the four strategies, three of them kind of all, the other three fall under disconnected youth: homelessness, hunger, the effect of incarcerated parents. So we've already started moving in that direction. This is going to take a lot of field work. Also, $25,000, as you gentlemen know, is not that much money, and to spread that over the four strategies might be a bit of a stretch. So we've decided to focus mainly on the disconnected youth. The consultant, I believe, and I bounce this all off the Governor's Office of Children, they agree with our assessment that is the way to go, because it is going to be quite involved and beyond what we as our management staff can really conduct to do it appropriately.
Are we still doing parents as teachers? With that group?
As of right now, I'll be making a presentation before the local management board in November at our meeting, and we'll be going over the four strategies and the timeline. The GOC has set a four-year transition period where this is the first step, data collection in light of or in regard to these four strategies. And then over the next 4 years, we'll be transitioning because all the money coming from the GOC, which as you know is in excess of $500,000, will have to meet these targeted goals. If we have programs that we have an affection for that are outside of these goals, we'll have to seek other funding for them. And these are all things we'll be discussing with the local management board in November.
Is that a yes? We're still doing parents and teachers?
We are still doing parents as teachers.
Thanks.
We are still doing parents as teachers, and we're trying to hang on to that over the next 4 years because we, myself and the local management board, find that program very valuable. So we might have to tweak it, might have to retool it a little bit, repurpose it a little bit, add a little bit to it to keep that up and running. Okay. I'm sorry if I confused you, but it's a four-year transition where the GOC is being quite clear, the money is for these four strategies.
All right, thank you.
And just one final for me, so as not to realize any duplication of effort here, I would assume that most of this, most of these statistics that you're going to get as a result of this grant will be shared with our youth services bureaus of the world and anyone else that is associated with any of the problems that would be
hit on
when they look at these things. So.
That is correct.
Okay. Okay.
All right. We have a motion and a second. Any other questions? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Right. Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you. Thanks, Vince.
Next, we have a briefing, discussion, and decision on a bid approval for the Everbridge Mass Notification. We have Scott Campbell, Director of the Department of Public Safety, Doug Brown, our Emergency Management Coordinator, and Cindy Miller from our Purchasing Office. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning, Commissioners. Good
morning.
Commissioners, we're here this morning to request your approval to issue a purchase order to Everbridge in the amount of $46,220. We're utilizing the GSA Schedule 70 contracts that we are allowed to use with the federal government.
So, going to need a little bit more on that.
Sure.
Oh, that sounds great, but what else
right,
you got?
Commissioners, what I'd like to do is ask Mr. Brown, our Emergency Management Coordinator, to elaborate on why the change and the benefit of the change, to get into that minutiae for you so you understand what's specifically being asked of you.
First, tell us what the Everbridge Mass
Absolutely.
Notification.
Good morning, Commissioners. And 3 weeks ago, when we came before you for the approval of the Urban Area Security Initiative grant, I made mention to you that a lot of our partners, law enforcement, municipalities, and others, had requested some different changes and modifications in our emergency notification system, which essentially is reverse 911, for lack of a better term. Everbridge notification system is that system. It offers the flexibility and usability that our partners in the county have asked for, and it offers a lot more flexibility. It also offers some additional paging platforms that can be utilized by all of those partners themselves, so they can manage their own for special groups or different things within their areas. And it also offers a very robust mapping system for when we have to do reverse 911. Additional features such as it has built-in parameters that we can built in by exchange, so that if you start a mass notification call, and let's say you're calling 1,000 phone numbers, it builds in so that we don't overload any specific exchange within the county. So they won't send more phone calls to any one exchange than the phone company says that exchange will happen, so that or handle, so that we don't overburden that. So again, this will expand our capabilities and allow us to continue to move forward in keeping our citizens informed.
Now, Doug,
yes,
the
sir.
School system already has something that I think is very similar, their Alert Now system, which allows them to auto-dial mass quantities, thousands and thousands and thousands of parents, or text to them. Is there any reason why we couldn't piggyback their Alert Now system?
Theirs is more based, sir, on a sign-up system, and specifically, actually, until as recently as a week ago, there was really no portal into that system unless you were the parent of a school child. They now have added a community portal so that you can sign up to get individual notifications about a school or a specific school emergency or program, but it really is not the same system as this. This system is specifically designed for us to pick a location. So for example, within the last week, we actually had a missing teen that the sheriff's office asked us to do a reverse 911. We picked an area geographically through some mapping, and then we're able to send it out. So it's more designed that it works specifically with the GIS, where the school board works more with the parents of the school children and not necessarily every citizen in the county. This will also give us the ability to put up on our front pages for our citizens to sign up that want to get those notifications, who may just have mobile phones, they no longer have home phones in their houses, they just use mobile phones, they won't be left out. They'll be included. We can pull them right into this piece.
So it takes that, it's more of a global.
Yes, sir.
Okay. UASI comes into play here, right?
Yes, sir.
I would assume that This is what, total with them, or what, funding?
Yes, sir. 100% of the funding is provided through the Urban Area Security Initiative grant that comes into the county. No additional county funding is required to make this happen at all.
Specifically, Commissioner, I apologize, this is pre-approved pending your actions, should you agree, the funding's there.
How labor-intensive is this, Doug? I mean, do you have to have like three people sitting in order to make this work, or is it easy?
It actually becomes easier, and which is one of the reasons we're looking to utilize this system. This system can be driven from, once we're up, from my iPhone. If I'm called to notify and say, put out a reverse 911, there's literally an app. Any computer with internet access, we can drive it off of. Requires no other capabilities within the county framework. Technology Services does not have to expend, for example, any man hours on this project to make it happen. It is all handled web-based and is very easy to activate.
And this might sound a little bit crazy, but I would assume that the ability for somebody else to get on there to put something wacko out is not there. I mean, the security, I'm sure, is built into the system so that, you know.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
It is tuned into, we control, and we keep very tight on those things for anyone who's allowed to initiate a reverse 911. However, it does then offer us the capability, which previous systems have not, that if the commissioners, for example, wanted to create their own paging group and the county administrator were to manage it, you could do that. You would add your own members, you would add your own people, and you would activate that at your leisure. You would not have to go through us. You would have all that activity.
Okay. All right. Do we have a motion to approve this bid?
So moved. Second.
Any other questions or discussion? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Okay. Thank you, Commissioners.
Thank you very much. Now we have Mr. Campbell staying with us. He's going to talk about a continued discussion and a possible decision on proposed fire prevention code plan review fee for service.
Thank you, Commissioners. And I'm going to be joined by Mr. Jason Green, the Chief of our Bureau of Permits and Inspections.
Jason, we always appreciate when you're willing to come back.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I did make a mistake by asking Jason to
join. No, I'm not.
So, I don't know.
So I do notice you couldn't sit through the bar.
So far, we're okay.
That's symbolic, you know. Just in body language alone. But go ahead.
First, Commissioners, I have just a one-page handout with some additional information. As a follow-up, we first came to you approximately a month ago. It was our initial visit with this. And today's visit is to follow up with that dialogue we had, and I have some information in response to that dialogue. So I'd like to give that to you, please.
Approach the bench. You always like to say that. Approach the bench.
You know. Thank you. About last week.
Commissioners, as I just stated, this is actually a return visit. Approximately 1 month ago, we came before you and first proffered the idea of implementing what I think is clearly more accurately described as a cost recovery system that is intended to retain on a county level a fair portion of revenue that's being generated by a fee that is already charged by the state, the Office of the State Fire Marshal. This is, and I cannot say more emphatically, this is not a proposed new fee. This is actually, I think, about as opposite of that as you can get. This is an attempt for the county to be able to recover or retain a portion of the revenue generated by a fee already charged.
Right, but the end user pays no more.
Actually, Commissioner, you'll be happy to hear that this revised proposal, depending on a rate that you may choose to adopt, you could actually reduce what an applicant would currently have to pay under the current circumstance. The proposal, I don't know if I was clear when I visited a month ago, but as a function of the State Fire Prevention Code, the proposal only applies to commercial, industrial, and multifamily residential occupancies. It does not apply to one and two family occupancies, as I believe there is a specific exemption or statement in the State Fire Prevention Code that states that the State Fire Prevention Code does not apply to one and two family dwellings. In follow-up to some of our dialogue last month, I did reaffirm with Mr. Larry Eisminger, who is the Chief Fire Protection Engineer with the Office of State Fire Marshal, and I'm very sorry to say that he has announced his retirement, so that's only good till the, I believe, sometime in December. Mr. Eisminger did reaffirm that the legislation that was adopted that would enable the Fire Marshal's Office to, and I'm quoting, would allow them to reduce the rates it charges by up to 50%. And I cannot say enough that they may, they're not required to, and up to 50%. It's not required to be 50%. That they can make those reductions in recognition of a local jurisdiction's contribution to this fire prevention code plan review process. It does, in fact, require the local jurisdiction to adopt a, again, this is how it's referred to in the enabling legislation, a fee schedule in order for the fire marshal to be able to reduce the rates that it charges, and that's based on a mutually agreed to reduction. It was made very clear that if no fee schedule is adopted, the fire marshal's office will actually be required to continue to charge its full rates and accordingly will retain 100% of any revenue those rates would generate. So the county would continue to get nothing for contributing what has been agreed to be half of the effort. That said, this same enabling legislation does not stipulate what the content of the local fee schedule would be. In other words, and this addresses some of the concerns that you gentlemen shared, it does not require the adoption of a specific rate or rates, so you would have that discretion. It does not prohibit the implementation of a flat rate, which is as we have proposed. It does not prohibit caps from maximums, something that was raised as far as trying to limit so that this rate cannot exceed whatever maximum fee that you may choose to implement. And it does not prohibit provisions as to how, for example, you may want to address extenuating circumstances. You could include that in your schedule if you are so inclined. So it requires the adoption of a schedule. It does not get into what that schedule entails. So you can use whatever rate you want, conditions you want, caps, whatever caveats that are in within spirit of that legislation. I will say, because it is a may, not a mandate as far as reductions, I feel compelled to say that if we were to adopt a rate that clearly was not even a stretch of being equivalent to what's currently going on, that would not be considered in compliance with the spirit of the reduction enabling legislation. And I do not think the state would reduce its rates by half if we were to adopt a fee schedule, but in essence set that fee at zero, just as an example. So hence our recommendation today is that we adopt this fee schedule, their term, at 3 cents a square foot as a flat rate. Accordingly, the piece of paper that I handed you gentlemen, if you look at the top half, I'd like you to see the difference between the originally proffered 4 cents a square foot and today's revised 3 cents a square foot to show you what the annual, based on fiscal year commercial permit activity, what the annual change or difference would be, the delta between 4 cents and 3 cents a square foot. Last fiscal year, FY15, would have been the largest difference, and that would be over $8,000 difference in revenue. And it actually, just three fiscal years prior in FY12, the difference was less than $4,000 between those two rates. To put a little better order of magnitude on it, the average difference based over 6 years, to take that fluctuation out, would be approximately $6,400, as you see just above the bold line in the middle. So again, my opinion, but I don't think a difference of revenue in $6,000 is going to be a major factor for you gentlemen to consider as far as what rate you charge. So I think hopefully that can be something that can be set aside. In addition to some other feedback we had when we were with you a month ago, Commissioner Weaver, I believe you may have mentioned or questioned about the fire inspector. So we just put some numbers together very quickly. We based it on a building inspector one in Mr. Green's office, an existing position. So the exact same pay grade, hourlies worked, annual salary, cost for additional payroll related expenses and benefits. We're estimating that a fire inspector one would cost the county $54,141 a year. And to try to put some perspective on the workload, we would envision that person conducting approximately two inspections for every commercial permit let, basically something mid-process and one at the end of the process. And Mr. Green and I have even had discussions that a position could actually take on some other responsibilities that would assist him, for example, residential sprinkler inspections, things like that. So that was only provided in response, again, to some feedback or some dialogue we had last month. So in a nutshell, Commissioners, what is being proposed to you today is to adopt a cost recovery system that would enable, A, the county to retain a fair portion of the revenue that's generated by the fee that's already charged by the state and will continue to be if you do not adopt. Just to be clear, they will continue to charge it, which means they will continue to retain 100% of that money. And B, based on the proposed rate of 3 cents a square foot, effectively implement a reduction in the cost to our commercial building applicants, because at worst case, they would pay the same rate they were already paying. And I believe I'm correct, Jason, that 90% or more of the county's commercial permit activity falls in the category that's currently charged 8 cents by the state. If you were to adopt 3 cents is the county share, it would be a 3 and 4, in essence, a 1 cent a square foot reduction compared to what they are currently paying. So in essence, it would, for lack of a term, would be a business incentive. And I'm confident that that would be considered satisfying the conditions to allow the reduction by the state as they have agreed to, pending your actions. So that's where we are, Commissioners.
Scott, is this revenue incremental, or is it already reflected in our budget? Do you know?
Well, at this point, Commissioner, there is no, there is nothing in the county's budget references revenue, because we don't currently experience that revenue, incur that revenue.
So this will be an incremental revenue source
for
us.
Yes, sir. This would show up as a revenue source that we currently do not have in our budget process.
Well, I would move to approve the 3 cent recommendation.
Is there a second?
I'll second that.
Questions or discussion?
So, okay, so that's your motion, is just to do that at this time. I'm questioning the fire inspector portion of this, but I guess we're going to cover that separately, or what are we doing here?
Well, Commissioner, to be very clear, I am not proposing.
Okay, that was just a suggestion, right, in order to provide this service.
It was in response to Commissioner Weaver had inquired last month we were here about that, and we just wanted to share those kinds of costs.
Okay.
I will say to you, Commissioner, that if you were inclined to take that next step, I think it's quite feasible, and we would even enhance the position beyond building or fire prevention code inspections, and to even more efficiently use that position, maybe do some additional work.
The reason I'm asking that, because it begs the question, if we approve this, we've got to have a way in which to perform these inspections, and I'm not sure you have the workforce to be able to do that.
Well, we
yes,
would.
Yes, no.
But we would, sir, if you want to get into the inspection aspect, the 3 cent is to do the fire prevention code plan review. The fire marshal's office, in their one half of the rate, would continue to do the inspections.
All right. I want to make sure that's clear. Okay.
It would strictly be, sir, if right, you were inclined to take on that role as well, we would need a one FTE, a full-time inspector, and this is our estimation of the cost.
Okay, I'm good. All right.
All right. Which,
if I could just make a quick point to that, you would then recover the entire fee that's now paid to the state fire marshal's office.
And well, that's kind of where I was going with this, because
I didn't know that.
That's a valid point here.
But even more so, Commissioner, once you take on the full responsibility, then the entire rate scenario becomes within your purview. Mm-hmm. There is no longer a state fire marshal's office involvement in the fire prevention code aspect. It's nothing to do with investigating fires and things like that, or investigating complaints for non-compliance on a state level.
I think you should bring that in front of the Board of Commissioners as an agenda item. I think that has to be a separate agenda item, doesn't it?
I would agree with that, and I'd also like to see the numbers that we would generate based upon the position. You know where I'm going here? Mm-hmm. The position is going to cost us this, but we're going to generate the revenue because we're doing it now instead of the state fire marshal, to see what that additional revenue is.
Yeah, well, I'm looking at the numbers here, Commissioner, and if we did the whole thing, and we charged a net of a total of 7 cents, which is a penny below the eight, we would bring in $56,000 a year, and the cost of the position is $54,000 a year, and we'd have control over the resource locally.
Well, Commissioners, we obviously will do exactly what's asked. We will put together an appropriate presentation, get back on your future agenda, and come back with that. Mr. Green and I will work together and put that together.
Yeah, that's right. We could, if we tweak that a little bit, you could see a little Better numbers there, so.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Any other discussion? All right, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All right, and you're going to be back with some more information for us, so we'll look forward to that.
Thank you very much, Commissioner.
Thank you, sir.
All right, next we have a briefing, discussion, and decision on concurrence to purchase the truck wash building. So we have Scott Mosier, our Deputy Director of Department of Public Works, and we have Eric Burdine, and what else we got going on?
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning, Commissioners. The Bureau of Building Construction, in cooperation with the Bureau of Purchasing, recommends approval to purchase a Barco Pruden building to house the truck wash at the Maintenance Center. The Bureau of Building Construction solicited three proposals and recommends accepting AMC's proposal as the lowest responsive proposal for $202,623. This price is within budget and no additional funding is being requested. Additionally, this request is for approval to award the structure only, and the remainder of the work on this project will be completed by county term contractors.
How much was the amount to get?
$202,623.
And what's the status of our existing structure? Do we have one?
There is no one for truck wash. We have a vehicle wash for cars. This is all part of that NDE or NPDS permit that we have to capture. Yes. But this will take care of that. And one thing I want to bring your attention to, Eric mentioned about the term contracts. The $200,000 award just for the building and the pieces to go with that. We also are hiring three, possibly fourth term contractor to do all the other work. We're acting as a general contractor here. We have rate prices that we've already negotiated with them in the term contract, and they'll continue to do all the work as we go forward. And we started some of that work, the anticipation of the building coming in about 12 weeks, 10 to 12 weeks.
Are there any other costs besides this, or is this it?
The 200, right now, if we put the whole thing together, we're well within budget.
Is that operating budget or capital you're using?
This is capital.
It's committed capital. It's in there. Okay.
12-week waiting period on the building?
10 to 12 weeks once we order it.
So this puts us in
we're going to miss the first snow.
This puts us in the middle of the winter.
Yeah.
Just let you wash your trucks and capture the salt inside the building.
Right now. That's correct. Yeah, and also in the summer for the equipment, the mowers, I mean, this washes everything because it's a hand wash. It's not just, right now we have the car wash, you run through it, I don't know if you've been through it or not, and it's automatic. You can't take a lawnmower through there. You can't take a bunch of equipment we have through it. This one's going to be large enough, even, I believe, the grader, Dean, does that
yes.
fit in?
Yes.
Yeah, everything fits in this equipment.
And it's all, it's not automated. It's going to be done by hand.
No, it's all manual.
Okay.
Nate, normally we would have the other bids. Do you have the other bids?
We do.
Yeah, we solicited three proposals for that.
Okay.
What were the three bids? Three bid amounts?
We had the low bidder. We had the second bidder was Steel Building Specialist. That was $203,670. The third was Myers Building Systems, and that was $227,541.
Okay.
And that was the three. Okay, it was $1,047 difference between the first and second bid.
Okay.
And then between the second and third was about $23,000.
Okay, so they're all close, all within 10%.
So are we comfortable with a low bidder, Scott or Eric? I mean, with just $1,000 difference in the bid there, did we vent all of that? I mean, are we good?
Yes, we went through it. Actually, AMC includes the piers for the building as well, where Steel Buildings does not.
Okay.
Okay.
So it's a better deal.
Mm-hmm.
All okay.
Right. Very good.
All right. Do we have a motion to approve?
So moved.
Second.
Any other questions or discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Our last thing on our agenda this morning is a briefing and discussion about use of formula appraisals by the Agricultural Land Preservation Program. So we have joining us Tom Devilbus, our Director of the Department of Land and Resource Management, Deb Bowers, our Program Manager for Ag Land Preservation, and J.P. Smith, our Preservation Specialist. Good morning.
Good morning, Commissioner.
Good morning, Commissioner.
Good morning.
We're here today to present a formula-based process for determining valuation related to proposed agricultural easement properties. This formula-based process has been reviewed and approved by the Agriculture Advisory Board. So we're here today to provide you with a briefing to allow for discussion, and we hope to receive your concurrence on moving forward with the next cycle, which is the FY16 cycle, in applying this formula-based process in the valuation. So I will turn it over to Ms. Bowers to entertain you.
Good morning. I'd like to say that Mr. Glenn Shirley, Chairman of the Ag Preserve Board, Preservation Advisory Board, wanted to be here this morning, but he had an electrical problem in his milking parlor last night. Had to be there for the technicians this morning, so he apologizes he couldn't be here this morning. Just wanted to give you a quick summary of our FY16 cycle, for which we had 20 applications received. The advisory board approved 18 of those, more than 2,500 acres. The average size farm is 140, so this is a really great group of farms we have applying this year. And this is going to be our inaugural use of formula appraisals in our Ag Land Preservation Program. So we wanted to brief you on that. First of all, the advisory board has reviewed and approved the formula, and it's based on traditional appraisals, how it is put together, and we'll give you some more detail on that. It's been in use, formula appraisals have been in use for more than 25 years. Montgomery County, I believe, was the county that devised them. Harford and Howard, Baltimore County uses them as well. The Maryland Rural Legacy Program used it when it first began in 1998, and Carroll County has been using them since 99 in the Rural Legacy Program. And area land values are delineated, and we do average those out. So the use of formula appraisals, we use point scores for these four areas: development potential and location, soil features and the farmability of a property, natural resource characteristics, and special attributes. For the development potential and location, we look at number of lot rights, proximity to town center, adjacent to an easement block. That's always something we like to see, whether it's inside an easement block that exists or adjacent to it, whether it's a multi-parcel deed, because this would typically add value. Soil features and farmability, farm size is important, acres of cropland and pasture, always important in our program. Class 1 and 2 soils would set some farms above others in terms of soil productivity. And adjacent land use. This is a farm surrounded by subdivisions or surrounded by other farms. These are things that a farmer would look at when getting ready to buy a farm. Natural resource characteristics. Most appraisers, when they look at a property, if it has a stream or if it has woodlands, that adds value. Wetlands may or may not add value, depends on your perspective, but we do give a few points for wetlands on a property. Special attributes include a property that has some ecologically sensitive areas, tourism or historic site, whether the property is an add-on to an existing easement by the same owner, adjacent to a park or state protected land, frontage on a major waterway or very close by. These are attributes that would add value to a property from an appraiser's point of view and certainly from our point of view. So the benefits of switching to a formula appraisal, we, over the last 6 years, our expenditures have averaged at $25,000 a year, what we have spent on appraisals. And the big benefit for the landowner is that it's going to save 2 to 3 months, maybe sometimes even longer. It took us to get through getting all the appraisals back for a given cycle and then having them reviewed by a review appraiser. This is a look at our formula worksheet. We're not going to go through this line by line, but this is what we use to derive the points. And the most important point that I will show you is the actual formula at the bottom.
Back up. Hang on a second.
The formula.
Give us just a second, then.
Okay. On the second page there, in the bottom portion, is where the formula actually takes place.
I don't see bike path compatibility on here.
No, you don't see that one on there.
I'm just curious, why would a formula like this take lot rights and rather than attribute a linear relationship between lot right values, put them in groups of 1 to 3, 4 to 6, 7 to 9? I mean, the difference between 3 lot rights and 1 lot right is night and day. Why would we group them and just say, hey, you get 100 points if you're anywhere between 1 and 3? That's counterintuitive to me.
Well, you would think so, but when we were using real appraisals, we talk with appraisers a lot about this. There's really not going to be a whole lot of change in value between, say, 6 lot rights and 7, or between 8 and 9. But several years ago, we had, long discussions with landowners and their attorneys fighting over one development right. And we are seeking to level the playing field somewhat. And grouping them like this, and I have to say that all of the landowners in this cycle that we're working with right now are getting almost all of those points. Almost all the landowners are getting all of those points. We add them. If you get the 100 points and you have 4 development rights, you will also get the 150 points. So you add those up. So then you have 250 points. If you also have at least 7 lot rights, you're going to get that 175 points as well.
So let me jump right across the page to section 4, the very first one on the top. In a targeted ecological or area or tourism historical site, 30 points. Is it 30 or nothing, or does the county subjectively apply some number between 0 and 30 there?
30 points.
It's 30 or nothing?
Pretty much 30 or nothing.
Yes.
Are all of the categories all or nothing, or are there some areas where you can subjectively apply a portion of the 30, like 15?
I think there are. No, these are all straight up points.
So they're yes or no. You either get the points or you don't. There is no subjectivity.
In this point score, no.
Okay. Is there, now you said in this point, no. Where, if any place, is there subjectivity in this evaluation system?
Not in this one. In our rural legacy formula, which is different from this one, there are, I think, 2 categories where you apply up to a certain number of points. So is there subjectivity? Yes. Sometimes there is.
A lot of the subjectivity comes from the individual attributes of different farms.
What I'm trying to figure out is if I took the 3 of you and gave you the same piece of land to evaluate and put you in 3 separate rooms and told you all to score this, would you all come up with the same number?
Yes.
We should, yes.
Okay. It's a good answer.
I think where there's a little bit of varying from the exact number is under section 2 and under section 3, where you determine those footages or the acres for soils and the footage for stream buffers and all. So there's some.
We're using the same. Actually, JP's mapping capability is a little bit better than mine. He's using actual GIS mapping. So I had him do measurements for streams and things like that. So it's going to be a little more accurate.
This wouldn't be any different than 3 different appraisers coming in very close in their
appraisal. Would have a lot more subjectivity with our appraisers, yes. We've had wide variances with appraisers, and that's one of the reasons we're going to formula.
Especially small properties with a few lot rights. We felt like we had quite a few outliers coming in at high values per acre that probably shouldn't have been so high.
And that is really one of the major reasons we're before you, is because some of the issues we've had in the past few years with those higher valuations, and Commissioner Rothschild appropriately flagged that. So this is our attempt, and we think a very good one. to try to level the playing field so we don't have those issues that continue to arise. And we can move forward with those properties using this formula-based as opposed to having to deal with those appraisal processes, which can get very cumbersome and very complicated at times.
So the maximum Go ahead. The maximum number of points you can get is 1,000.
Right.
The number of lot rights subtotals to about 425.
Right.
Suppose a farm has 15 lot rights.
Well, part of this scale has to do with Senate Bill 236, where they're only allowing a certain amount of lots per parcel. So that's a lot of times they don't come into play if they have more than 7 or 9 lots.
I understand.
So what we did was we added some things to that section to sort of level out the playing field. If you had a lot of if you were going to relinquish all of your remaining lots, or if you were adjacent to an easement block, or if you had a multi-parcel deed, we figured that would help if you had 15 lot rights, but you're only getting credit for 9.
And that's half your points right there.
That's half of your points is in your development potential. So,
is there any concern that over the course of years going forward, I mean, we know the further we go, the more challenging it gets. You know, you have more development, you have municipalities, you have all kinds of stuff going on, that this is a criteria that will carry us fairly far into the future, or is this something that's really going to kind of need to be, maybe looked at and kind of tweaked maybe every year or two? Or because I suspect that, things right now that still fit the, I mean, I'm sure 10 years ago it was easier to find, properties to put in easements, and it's going to get progressively more challenging to meet certain criteria, right?
Well, we still have high demand for the program. These criteria, I think, will match just about any farm that comes in. The beauty of the formula is we can tweak it if necessary. If we had a high number of farms come in that for some reason just aren't scoring right, we'd have to look at it, and the advisory board would make changes to what we have. I don't know if that answers your question or not.
Let me take a shot.
Sure.
Let me take a shot, maybe. A lot of the features here in sections 2, 3, and actually 4, those are basic farm attributes that you would like, no matter what type of program you had, whether it's a MAF program, whether it's Rural Legacy, the Maryland Agricultural Land Preservation Foundation. Whichever program you looked at, those are basics. Those are the foundations of those programs, good soils, lots of acres. Even though the streams and things are good attributes on farms, water supply and those types of things. I think the biggest criteria to look at is the section 1 where we have the development potential. And that is the second piece of the foundation for ag preservation, because let's face it, that's a big part of what we're trying to do is retire development rights and preserve land for agriculture. So I think the sections below section 1 are pretty much standard. They're going to remain like that. I think the section 1 is an attempt here at this point in time to again address the issue we had with the overvaluations as far as the ag preservation program went, and to try to make it meld into the current situation with development in the state and county. And so to answer your question, Commissioner, I think if anything, that section 1 may need to be reviewed periodically and said, okay, are we still on target, still on track right with what we want in the program? But I think the others are pretty much set, would be set.
Okay. And certainly any relief in terms of that legislation would make a big difference in terms of...
And it could.
Yeah.
And we would revisit that. Mm-hmm. And keep in mind, I don't want to steal Deb's thunder because she's getting to this point. The whole how we determine the valuation or what we apply here is very important. I think it might help answer your question here. So I'm gonna,
okay,
if that's okay, I'll let Deb move forward unless you have... Commissioner, I know you want to say something.
Go ahead. No, that's all right. Go ahead.
Okay.
Go ahead.
So that's our worksheet. This is the actual formula at work at the bottom of the sheet. As you can see, there are three formula, what we call a multiplier. They're running along the top there, 6.11, 7.11, and 7.33. The 6.11 is in the northwest region, and that equates...
Right under the picture.
Slow down. What are all those numbers you're
the
going...
The first line right under the picture, right, Rich.
Oh.
I know, but I don't know what those numbers mean, 6.117.
I know, I'm about to explain that. 6.11 is... $6,110 was the average appraised value in the northwest region.
Mm-hmm. Per acre.
So when you're applying 1,000 points, that's how the number comes out, 6.11. Then 7.11, same thing. The average up in the Manchester, Hampstead region, $7,110 or whatever. Well, I guess it was 10.
Mm-hmm.
And then central is Westminster, and above Westminster and below Westminster. We didn't go down into the Woodbine area this year because we didn't have any applicants from that area. So you take the number of points and you use it, use those multipliers. So next slide, here's an example. Let's just say 140 acres, because that's our average size farm in this group. Let's just say it got 950 points. So then you would multiply that times 6.11, because we're just saying it's up in the Tawnytown area. And then that will give you your fair market price per acre, $58.04.50. And we put the cents in there. Times 140. And then that gives you the fair market value. Then in the next part, you take the fair market value and you derive the 70% of that fair market value. And I have your final easement offer there with question marks, because sometimes there are adjustments made in title work. If the acreage is different, you know, we would have to make adjustments. But that 508963 is the 70% of fair market value.
So let me just take the most obtuse case. So we have somebody comes to us and they want to put their 100 acres into Ag Pres, but they have a zero lot rights, which means the maximum points they can get are 500 points, right?
Mr. Rothschild, if they have zero lot rights, they are not eligible for the program.
All right, then I'll take the next most obtuse case. They have 100 acres with only one lot right. So the most points they can get is approximately 650?
If they only have one lot right, they probably are not going to get into the program either, because that would indicate that they've used probably more than half of their lot rights.
A difficult situation that we've had in the past is just a chunk of fields, maybe say 40 or 50 acres, that have few lot rights. In this formula situation, it would come out much cheaper per acre for us to buy, you know, put an easement. If they qualify with the amount of lots and different things like that, small pieces of property have less attributes. They may not have a stream, they may not have woods, they may not have a lot of things that they would normally get points, you know, if they were a larger farm. And when we were getting those appraised in the past, especially if they were closer to town, they were fetching a higher offer per acre.
Thank you. Tom, I appreciate what all you've done here, and it's creative, and I can see some benefits to it. When we originally had this discussion, my concern was just having some boundary limitations, because we had one or two that went into Ag Pres over the years that were pushing $200,000 per lot right. I just thought that was excessive, and we were just trying to put a fail-safe in so that couldn't happen. But that could still happen with this algorithm here.
No.
I don't think so.
We still have some numbers to show you where some of even the current applicants are falling in at this with this formula appraisal.
If we can continue, we'll show you our sample testing. Sample formula testing.
Okay, thank you.
That 50-acre parcel with no lot rights is already in Ag Preservation.
Right, it's already preserved. It can't be built on.
Yes, that is correct.
Can't be built on. And, you know, you're looking at, say, $3,000 an acre here, $4,000. You go to other counties where they put a bond issue, it's $40,000 an acre they're paying for these land rights. Carroll County is getting a lot of value for where they are, and I probably shouldn't bring that up in public here.
I agree with your statement, but the prior Board of Commissioners, this was a major policy debate we had here several times on whether we're preserving acres or extinguishing lot rights. And the board was never unified on that. I always took the position we're extinguishing lot rights, so that if you only got zero or one or two lots on 100 acres, why bother?
You're preserving agribusiness. You're not preserving lots as such. This is
we're trying to extinguish lots.
Well, you're extinguishing lots, but you're preserving the business of agriculture in this county is what you're actually doing.
Well, and it's rural nature, and I mean, there's other aspects to it too, which is why I always won those arguments.
Here we have a formula testing sample from our FY14.
Okay, so. Go ahead, Deb. Ignore our petulance.
I'll just switch it back to our screen here. This is the formula testing sample of our actual FY14 properties, and this shows you the difference. That it gives you the property, the number of lot rights that we were dealing with last year, then the appraised fair market value per acre, and those were with traditional appraisals, okay? Then in the column next to that, it gives you what our formula fair market value per acre provided, and the difference between them. We are within 10% in all of these cases. Some are very close, some are just, you know, a little bit less, some are a little bit more. So I think when we're done, it will be very close. It'll be pretty much a wash in terms of costs. And I think, you know, our major, our mission is to provide fair offers for the landowners and fairness also for the taxpayers. And I think this formula is going to deliver that. In our next slide, we have a continued looking at last year, showing the 70% of the appraised fair market value, and then compared to the formula, 70% fair market value. again, I think a very acceptable difference in terms of plus or minus. And that last column is what was actually paid out for that particular property.
Deb, can you go back to that prior slide?
I'm sorry?
Can you go back to the prior slide?
Uh-huh.
Is it my imagination, or do we seem over when there's more acreage?
Where you see over what?
We're higher. The formula is higher than the appraisal when we have...
The formula was derived from averages of actual appraisals, which on the left are the actual appraisals.
I understand that, but if you look at, we're over when we have 200 acres, we're down when we're at 120, we're over when we have 187. Go ahead and flip to the next screen.
Mm-hmm. I see what you're saying.
We're over with 212, we're over with 187, we're under. I mean, if we're over on the big ones and under on the small ones, we're not going to even out.
That's correct, because the number of acres that have the higher correct. It's not when you do a weighted average, it's going to be a overall higher net cost.
Right. Well, right, it's also higher per acre, and then multiplied by the acre as well.
That's what I mean. Yes, yeah. It's a higher weight because there's more acres, so it could have a net increase in cost to us. We'll, biases in favor.
We will pay more for a larger farm
than we did before.
Not necessarily.
No.
Yeah, but,
no.
I agree with Commissioner Howard. We got two farms at 200 acres, and they're high.
Never mind.
Plus, it's leveraged through more acres.
Right.
The small farms are lower, but you have less acres weighting against it, so the net effect is a weighted increase, which is higher. Even if you just did a simple sum of the average of the. Differences and averaged them out, and it came to zero because you have more acres in the large farms, and that's where the heavier price per acre is going to mean a net increase in cost for us, That's Commissioner Howard's point, right?
Right.
Except if you look at the last two on it, you have 95 acres, which was the difference was a plus 5.4%. Then you have 121 acres, which the difference was a minus 0.8%. So you have the greater amount of acres, actually less money.
Yeah, but then look at the 187 and the 212.
We only have five examples up here.
Well, but the next
there's five more.
There's five more where the pattern starts to reappear.
No, it's the same.
It's the same ones. It's just the 70% rather than the fair market value.
Yeah.
And then we also have what they actually got paid per acre.
This was to show you that the differences are acceptable. I mean, we could talk all day about how the formula is going to work compared to how appraisals work. We saw wide swings in appraisals sometimes for very similar properties.
I mean, I've always been very supportive of this program, but I do want to ask, given all the other things that we're trying to deal with, if the program's in very high demand, we're not seeing any shortage of applicants, and we're working on a formula, shouldn't the formula be getting us more for less?
That remains to be seen. I mean,
shouldn't that be our goal, is what I'm saying?
Well, our goal is to contain costs in the same way that appraisals did and our bidding system did.
Right, but I'm just saying, if we're looking at what we're doing, I mean, supply and demand would suggest if there's no shortage of applicants, wouldn't it be reasonable to say, well, then we should be paying a little bit less when we're designing?
That is a policy choice. I'm providing 70% here because that is our cap and that is what we paid most of our applicants in the last cycle. It's always a policy choice to pay less than 70%.
Well, but we're determining what the fair market value is.
Right.
Keep in mind, this is perpetuity, Joe. And you get much less than this, and you're going to have a major decline.
This is our testing that we've done on our FY16 applicants, okay? So we've taken out the number of acres and
lot rights
that we've derived so far, just so to protect
that first
identities.
Acre, that fair market value per acre is incorrect. It needs to be corrected to 62.33.
Yeah, down at the bottom. Down at the bottom.
That was my mistake.
So the formula. So what's the total of all these? Do we know?
No, we didn't. You mean total up the?
If we do them all, what we're gonna spend?
These aren't final numbers.
You want to know how much we think FY16 is going to cost us? We are looking at about $7 million to $7.4 million is our estimate for what this current cycle that we're working on.
You have what the last cycle would have cost us if we wanted the formula instead of appraisals?
No, I haven't worked that up. No.
We're very close to the average per acre cost as we were last year.
The formula can be used to save money, but that's a policy choice. I didn't work that into the formula. The formula is built to give us comparable values.
I understand.
So that the offers we make this year are similar to what people are expecting over what they heard about last year.
Okay.
And actually, if you go back to the slide, the higher what we're over on from what we played with the appraisals is, in my opinion, lot rights. We're seeing more lot rights per acre, and we're paying more money for that.
It's true. Always, if you have more lot rights and higher number of acres, those are going to cost us more, yes.
That's a fair point. Okay.
That's our last slide.
Okay. All right. Any questions? All right.
So as you look at these going forward, it's going to be based on the formula?
Yes.
Okay.
Well, we have to vote on this. This is a briefing today.
No, we're not asking for a vote. We wanted to provide the information so that it's out there.
Okay, well, then back up a second. Would you go back to the first slide that had the two pages showing the criteria? Because there's a policy issue that's arising again, and I want to remind the commissioners and the public, you know, when we experienced unprecedented growth in the 90s and 2000s, one of the benefits of agricultural preservation, besides ensuring the continuation of agriculture in our county, was it reduced demands for more public facilities. We're now reaching a situation with schools where, if I wanted to take the argument to its extreme, we've been so good at some of these things, coupled with what's going on at the state regs, that we're experiencing growth levels that are not sufficient to even maintain enrollments. And going back to that, Deb, would you go to the chart?
You mean the worksheet?
The very top right there. Can you expand that? Can you zoom that a little bit on the top right? Zoom that a little bit to like 65% or something like that, so I can read it.
Sorry.
I'll take it up one more, 60, maybe try 75. I think I can read it there.
I don't know if it'll change it.
Okay.
No, it changes.
It says here, green belts for village boundary. And Mr. Hager brought up a question of whether or not that's a public policy discussion we need to have, whether we want to establish green belts around these towns.
Yes.
I don't know the answer to that.
Mr. Rothschild, we're not creating green belts around towns. Landowners are creating green belts around towns. We don't target properties according to where they are. We don't target properties, period. So when you see green belts being created around your towns, it's because the landowners have put those farms into preservation because they're good soils, you know, just historically speaking. Soils around towns are the best soils and therefore the most productive, most profitable farms, and that's why they are creating green belts around towns. This isn't only happening in Carroll County, this is happening in Lancaster County and other places.
Hang on, Deborah. I disagree with you. If we're giving points for the creation of the green belt, then we're using tax money to encourage the creation of the green belt.
We're giving points because they are near a town.
Green belt for a village boundary.
And that plays into the smart growth thing as well. The state has been viewing our rural legacy program according to how we value properties in our Ag Pres program. That's part of the reason why I use the word green belt, and part of the reason why that's in the special attributes category.
Keep in mind the goals of this program, the objectives of it. They're not to preserve green belts, not to preserve parks or anything. They're to preserve agricultural business, agribusiness in this county.
I agree with that statement.
This is up to the individual landowner. This is only a mechanism where they can preserve that farm in perpetuity to stay agricultural.
But the question that arises, Commissioner, is if we've got two identical farms characteristically, and one of them is 3 miles outside of Hampstead, and the other is right up adjacent. Let's use a better one. Let's use New Windsor. And one of them's 3 miles outside of New Windsor, and the other one's right up against the town boundary. In this case, the one up against the town boundary, the village boundary, would get more points. It arguably doesn't do anything to further the goal of continuing agriculture, but it also has the effect of making it more difficult for some of these small towns to expand that are increasingly finding it hard to amortize their water and sewer costs to go over such small populations, as evidenced by Union Bridge in New Windsor.
One of the reasons the ones near towns are getting more points is because the appraisals are coming in with those properties being more valuable, and we are trying to mirror appraisals with our point formula.
And keep in mind, the town has, before this goes through, they have to weigh in on this somewhere down the line.
Yes,
right?
Yes, they do.
So they always have a chance to weigh in on the properties. But here again, this is the individual property owner, the property rights of that individual to choose to do this, or we choose not to take this.
I'm sorry, Commissioner. I think we're in the same ballpark, but not on the same on the pitcher's mat here, because using a point system which attributes values to a piece of property based on its characteristics. Now, on the left side of the sheet, there's already points being given based on whether you're less than 3 miles or more than 3 miles from a town center.
This formula does not rank a property in whether we would choose it over another. This only goes to value an individual property. I think that you're losing sight of that. We're not ranking one property over the other.
But listen to me, these are redundant. If I take what Deb said at face value, on the very left side of this, the top left sheet, it says location of property. If you're less than 3 miles right to the town center, you get plus 50 points. If you're greater than 3 miles, you get plus, I can't even read, is it minus 50 or plus 30?
Plus 30.
Plus 30. But then we do it again on section four.
That's
we say that if it's
a little different in the section four. It says it's for a green belt or a village boundary or priority funding area. In the state smart growth law, that is considered a good thing to be putting a green belt around a village boundary. I mean, it's...
If I could...
Well, suppose it goes around for PFA, but it's in the DGA, or the preferred...
No, we're not given points if it's in a DGA.
If I could...
Go ahead, Tom.
Purpose here is not to create controversy or to create any new policy decisions from you all. So I think that we can go back and we can either remove this or we can establish maybe something else that can go in places, because it's not the intent. This is not intended to promote green belts around the municipalities. If they are occurring, it was intended to provide some type of credit for if that is happening, but is not the goal of the program, nor has it ever been the goal of the program to create these or promote this. We, as Commissioner Weaver said, folks enter into the office, if their farms qualify, they're processed, and we move forward with them if they are good farms. So there's never any solicitation or intent to create this, but I do not want this formula to even give that inclination that is part of what the Ag Preservation Program is about. So if you would like, we certainly can revisit that point right there.
If you took that point out, though, then the farms that you're looking at around towns, municipalities, whatever, will actually be your formula
value
will
less.
Give them less money than what they would get from
right.
appraisal.
Right, and typical therefore, those appraisals, people they're always be, higher.
Wait, right.
Wait, but except we would the location of the property, that criteria in the first section would still be applicable and would still be applied.
Yeah, right. And aren't there really different objectives? I mean, this is an opportunity. I mean, the formula should be an opportunity for us to move away from traditional appraisal thinking, because the purpose of an appraisal is different than the purpose of what we're trying to do here. I mean, the purpose of an appraisal is to pay someone, you know, a fair value for what their property is based on what they could do with it. But in terms of the program itself, I mean, it actually means more to us in some respects to find things that are not on top of towns. Now, I mean, doesn't it? I mean, or
no, I would say we're looking for good soils.
Well,
good
no,
acres,
we definitely are, but
you know,
I'm just saying,
and you know,
because
that's all I'm saying.
Right, no, I understand, but I guess what I'm saying, because then the conflicting argument is when it comes to future growth, you also don't want to pin in a town either. And so there's sort of a natural, I mean, don't we, or?
I'm not sure, Commissioner. I mean, I always envisioned our master plan as we have designated growth areas where our municipalities would grow and thrive, and we would then preserve and try to maintain the open spaces and rural character of the remaining part of the county. I mean, that's
right.
As long as I've been here, that's what my impression or feeling of our county master plan was, and I personally am very sold on that philosophy. And I think we've done an excellent job. And if you go around the state, you talk to state people, Maryland Department of Planning, as much as they want to say we're sprawl, and they'll also turn around and say that Carroll County's done a great job of creating these communities, supporting these communities, and then preserving those areas outside with a rural character. So I don't want to mix the two programs here if we can't, because again, the whole goal of Ag Preservation is to get production agriculture for that economic base,
right.
And it is a huge economic base.
Mm-hmm.
That's the purpose here.
Sure.
And part of that purpose, unfortunately, the way we achieve that purpose is we have to evaluate development rights, which sometimes I think gets very clouds the water up. But then where those acres come from, to me, as long as we're outside the designated growth areas, it's open. There's nothing that we have in our policies or anything that says we should not be looking at something that's immediately adjacent to the growth areas. Now, having said that, if this statement here creates angst, then I think that we can reevaluate. I don't have a problem with that because I do not want to create that controversy with you or with this program. That's not what this intent is. Okay? We were trying to mimic appraisal process the best we could to be as fair to everybody as we could.
Yes.
So this is a good conversation to have with you, because if you do not think that that is the appropriate verbiage or whatever, then we can reevaluate that, and we will.
And this is the same formula used throughout other counties?
Well, it's very similar, yes.
Very
and,
similar.
And it's similar to our rural legacy formula, and I think that's where some of this controversy is coming up, because I'm a grants writer for the rural legacy program. So sometimes I will mix those same things when they decide how much of a grant we're going to, and granted we only got half the amount this past year as we got last year, but when they look at our map, our preservation map, they like to see all that green space around the towns. That's the current thinking, and I like to get as much money as I can for land preservation. So,
and keep in mind, the big picture is some of the most productive soils in this country are from Virginia up through central Maryland into Lancaster area of Pennsylvania. It's also the most sought after soils for development. And if we don't do something along these lines, our grandchildren or great grandchildren down the road, we'll be in trouble here as far as feeding people in the world. So it's a balancing act. And we do have things in place, and I think they've done a great job so far of keeping this balance going between development and future food sources or production of food for future generations.
Well, let me try to address this. First off, I want you to know I'm sensitive to the fact we're really trying to pull this through three different knot holes. One knot hole is trying to structure it in such a way, as Deb just said, that we maximize our eligibility for grants. I appreciate that. The second knot hole is trying to come up with criteria which will mimic an appraisal to the greatest extent possible. The third knot hole, which is gets more of the policy, is we do this for the benefit to promote the general welfare of the county. It may be very subjective. And the question is, are there some farms where the benefits of putting them, not putting them in ag pres, exceed the benefits of putting them in ag pres? So it is a balancing act, Commissioner Weaver. And certainly to suggest we tweak the criteria doesn't mean we don't want to continue forward with ag pres. I think all of us do. I have a question for you, Tom, though. In this one thing that you've offered to tweak, and I appreciate that, but I do want a clarification. It says here, green belt for a village boundary or priority or a priority funding area, PFA. So if I'm looking at a town and I get outside of the PFA, what's typically immediately on the other side of the boundary from a PFA? Aren't we getting into a growth area then?
Yes,
you got
we are.
So this is giving points for putting farms in that are in the growth area, the way this
but
is structured right now.
Only because the appraisers value them higher.
I've acknowledged that.
If they're in the designated growth area, they would not. It can't be even, no.
Oh, really?
The program does not.
The appraisals.
The program does not encourage nor consider farms within the designated growth areas.
Okay, so what does this mean then? Green belt for a village boundary or priority funding area? But if I put a green belt around the priority funding area, I could very well be in the deed in the growth area.
It means adjacent to. Adjacent to
that's
green belt or
I think you need to
boundary.
Work on this one, Tom, and I'll just leave it at that. We're beating it to death.
I agree with you.
Mm-hmm.
If you change the verbiage, I think you'll get where we need to get.
Yeah,
I want to be clear where we need to get. Are you saying that we should eliminate this if they are adjacent to whatever verbiage you have, adjacent to a designated growth area, adjacent to a priority funding area, and those terms are different in different places, so I want to But are you saying that you don't want this criteria in here at all for that? Or are you saying we should modify it to make sure it's very clear where those areas are, and they are outside those growth areas, and they are outside those, and I say that
I'm
can
going to
be
give you an answer that's correct, but you probably won't like it. The problem is we have two conflicting goals that are incongruent. The property owner wants the highest possible value, and he says, hey, I'm adjacent to the PFA. My farm's worth more. Valid argument. From the town's perspective, hey, don't hem me in. I may need to put a food store outside of Union Bridge or New Windsor 5 years from now. And you start valuing farms higher that are right outside our PFA, you're going to strangle us. So we have incongruent goals. The property owner wants as much as he can get. The town wants room to breathe in case they have to grow, especially with the challenges of these new ENR wastewater treatment plants they're trying to pay for. They need more population in order to be able to stay alive. If they don't grow, they'll die in some cases, is my concern.
Tom, you made a point that I think is well taken, and really what it needs to do is just properly reflect what we're doing in the master plan, right?
Yes.
And so I think that's kind of what we're speaking to in terms of maybe looking at that. Is that?
Well, yes, and if that's the case, then I would say, you know, we are trying to preserve lands outside the designated growth areas, and maybe, so my question is, if that is what the master plan indicates, and I think it does, and then do we want to recognize farms that are immediately adjacent to those designated growth areas and or priority funding areas, because it could be next to a rural village and be a priority funding area, not to confuse things, but so do we want to add some value to that in this process or not?
Well, the question,
and that's the question, I guess, I'd like to walk away from here today.
Sure.
Be able to,
and I think that is the relevant question, and I guess I'll turn it back and ask you, because I think the question really for me is, certainly preserving land outside the growth area is the objective. If something's just outside the growth area, does that make it more of the objective or less of the objective?
It's not part of the objective, is the answer. The commissioners and this program has never delineated any other areas in which
Let me ask it a different way.
In
terms of executing the master plan, though, does it help us more or less if a property is very close to the growth area?
Now, you're going to step out of my expertise because Mr. Hager probably should be here to answer that question fully. But I would say I don't see where it hurts the master plan as it's laid out, because we just went through a master plan and our designated growth areas remained where they were, and our agricultural areas and our zoning stayed outside of them. So we didn't make any modifications to our designated growth areas to expand them or shrink them,
right,
at that time. Keep in mind, those designated growth areas are in the county. They're not in the municipality. So
we
made no adjustments at this time. Let me follow up with your question,
sure,
Commissioner, because I think when you asked, you said about the proximity there. The master plan issue is one. The valuation issue is another. And I think there's two separate things we're talking about here. And what we're trying to do is say the value of that property, no matter what we think about the master plan or whether it should or shouldn't be, in an appraisal process, the value of that property
would
is considered
higher if it was
right,
closer, right.
So we can rewrite this and word it maybe differently, but the end product is going to,
because you're trying to reflect the appraisal
same
process.
Yeah, right. It may be the same, right, that you give more points.
From an appraisal standpoint, this is perfectly reasonable. But Doug,
right,
let me clarify something, Commissioner Howard. Let me rephrase your question. You asked the question was, well, if it's right outside a growth area, but this criteria says if it's outside the priority funding area. Well, PFA, that's the epicenter of where we, the growth area is usually outside of the PFA. If this said outside of the growth area, I would have less problems with it, but it says PFA.
And we can
You see what I'm getting at?
That's a change we can make.
Mm-hmm.
If it's appropriate, that can be done.
PFA is the town itself.
So
the growth area is outside of the
that
PFA.
That can be clarified to make sure it's
you
very
clear.
You
want to restrict personal property rights?
It's not a matter of restricting property rights. It's a question of what artificial incentives or policies do we put in place to perhaps purchase land or rights that might have a detrimental effect
own that property in right outside that area, you want to restrict their ability to preserve it.
No,
mm-hmm.
I
that's
think
what they
Commissioner
want to
Howard
do.
Said it. I think the other day he said you don't have a natural property right to be bought into AgPres. It is an elective program that we offer. based on criteria. We could choose to say we're not going to put anything in Ag Pres unless it perks. That would not be denying someone property rights. It would just be qualifying what we want to put
well,
into
or
it.
Or we could, I mean, not that I would ever suggest this, but you could have no program at all.
We're going to have none at all.
It wouldn't deny someone their property rights, right.
It's difficult. You said it very well, Commissioner Weaver, earlier. You said it's a delicate balancing act, and it we're just trying to get the balance right now that we're moving away from appraisals. And I don't want to see something that drives us in a direction which is inconsistent with the master plan.
But what I hear Tom saying is you think you can get, I mean, the formula process itself is something I don't think we're struggling with. Okay. And you're saying you think you can maybe clarify that just a little bit so that we can not
clarify
in conflict.
And let you know how that let you review that language. And I think that we can clear this up as long as you're okay with the appraisal, with this formula addressing those areas outside, giving them some type of added
And actually, I mean, I think we've just demonstrated one of the benefits of having a formula process as opposed to strictly an appraisal process, which is this would be a moot point if we didn't have a formula. The reason we can actually have a discussion about what makes some sense longer term or whatever is because even though you're trying to emulate the appraisal process, I get that. There may be times where it needs a little bit of a tweak, which would not be in our purview if we were simply using outside appraisals.
That's correct.
So there is some benefit in that.
And just so you know where this comes from, I mean, I've had business people, I've had realtors come to me and say, you know, you're putting a noose around some of these towns. They don't have the land they need to grow. And I know within limits, we're not trying to turn them into major metropolises, but if they need to put a shopping center in to put a food store, I hate to see us extinguishing those possibilities through an ag press policy, which has perhaps needed a little bit of refinement,
but we can't
which is what Commissioner Howard said.
Right, but we can't put too much burden on Ag Pres either. Those municipalities need to be looking forward and addressing that through the master planning process.
Right.
Thank you.
Agreed. Yes. So if they don't, you know, we just can't hang wait until someone gets the wild hair to do something. So
yes, thank you.
That's the opposite of planning, right? Okay. Any other questions?
All right.
You notice every time you ask a question, we throw one at you, right?
I know. That's okay, why I'm not going to.
Yeah.
I think this was an important discussion to have.
And yes,
Yeah.
Exactly.
And it's important for you to know you have the right to remain silent. So.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you, guys.
All right. Thank you very much, guys.
We will be back.
All right. See you. All right. Last on our agenda this morning.
There's an agenda.
We've got our admin, which is really just going over agendas for the next 2 weeks. Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday, Commissioners Wance and myself will be in New York for the credit rating agency visits. And our staff's put together a very good process to really act on what we did with the bond resolution today. Tuesday, we have... do not have admin session, so that is not correct. That needs to come off. Wednesday is planning and zoning, Commissioner Weaver, Commissioner Rothschild. Thursday is the agribusiness breakfast.
Wednesday night. We made changes to Wednesday.
Wednesday at 4:30, we need to add an admin session.
Closed admin?
Yep.
Yes.
Yep.
Yes, you're right. Okay, Thursday morning, agribusiness breakfast at 8, Commissioner Weaver and Rothschild. Then we have some business to do.
I have a question. Thursday, are you going to have a closed admin then or not?
We should have a closed...
Or you're just going to do it at 4:30 on Tuesday, Wednesday.
Let's just do one at 9 on Tuesday. No, we're not going to be... Yeah, so let's just do one at 9 on Thursday.
No, too tight. Have to be 9:30 because we have the ag breakfast from 8 to 9.
Well, we got session at 10.
Maybe 9:15.
All right, let's shoot for 9:15. See how it goes. That morning, we also have the rezoning case. We have minutes in admin. We'll be closed for land acquisition. Commissioners Wance, Frazier, and Rothschild will be attending the vine cutting at the Old Westminster Winery. The afternoon, we have an afternoon session. We're going to talk some about our strategic planning process. I also want to put on the agenda for that afternoon the revisiting of this discussion about where transportation should be in the government structure. It was on last week's agenda. We didn't.
Is that the citizen services?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But just that piece of it, I think.
Oh, just transportation.
Yeah. Thursday evening, Commissioner Wentz will be at the Westminster Lions Club 75th Anniversary Gala. Commissioner Rothschild will be at the Department of Rec and Parks Volunteer Appreciation Award program in Eldersburg. And I might be there as well. On Friday, November 6th, Commissioner Wentz will be at the Veterans Day Breakfast at Francis Scott Key. Mr. Frazier has the commissioner's report. The following week, Monday, November 9th, Commissioner Wentz will be at the Pills to Street Drugs presentation at Carroll Hospital Center. We will have admin on Tuesday, November 10th. And then we also have some admin time scheduled there as well, don't we?
It'll be all day.
It'll be all day. Well, that's mm-hmm. exciting.
8 to
4:30. That's personnel, right? I mean,
on the 10th.
Yes.
Okay.
What day is this?
Tuesday the 10th.
Tuesday, 8. So it's going to be 8 to 5, 8 to 4?
Yes.
We need 8 hours to do 4 interviews?
8 to 5.
Pardon?
We need 8 hours to do 4 interviews?
5, and there's also regular closed admin.
We're interviewing 4.
4. It is 4 now.
It's yeah. 4.
See if we can shorten that up a little bit.
Yeah,
maybe
take it 8 to 3 or 8 to 4, something like that.
8 to noon.
Well, when we're done, we can leave.
Say what?
When we're done, we're going 8 to noon.
8 to noon would be good, man.
But I won't be able to do that because we need an hour each for the interview.
Yeah.
It's 4 hours.
All right.
So then an hour and a half for hour for admin is 5 hours, and then some dead time.
Lunch.
6 hours maybe. So 8 to 2 maybe.
Yeah. Okay.
I'll speak with Kim and see if she's scheduled anything.
Okay.
Wednesday, November 11th is Veterans Day. It says here Commissioner Weaver is going to be at North Carolina High School. And then at the Board of Ed meeting later that day. And then Commissioner Frazier will be at the City of Westminster Veterans Day celebration. I think I'm doing something in Sykesville that day.
Yeah, I've got two things that aren't on there. I'll be at Winter's Mill at 7:30 for their breakfast. And then there's a ceremony at Tawnytown, American Legion 11, that I'll be at.
And Denise, would you see if you can schedule me for South Carroll? I have to see what day it is, obviously.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe Gerstel. Usually attend Gerstel also.
And if we find any others, we'll just pass them to you. Because there'll be a bunch of them,
there's
I'm sure.
A bunch of them on, yeah.
Thursday, we have regular session. Mr. Weaver will be at the American Legion ceremony to honor a soldier. And then we have a joint Board of County Commissioners, Board of Education meeting on the afternoon of the 12th. And then Commissioner Rothschild has the commissioner's report.
Commissioner Howard,
yeah.
Do we want to make any statement about what we're hoping to do in admin in the next week or so?
No, I think we need to just put our thoughts together.
Okay.
Yeah. All right. Anything else? If not,
we adjourn.
You're not getting off that easy. Yeah, we recessed to 1:30 and then we're back here for an afternoon mm-hmm. session. We have a motion to recess.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Carroll County government now streams live right to your smartphone. Go to carrollcountymd.iqm2.com.